You're listening to the audio production of Decide and Conquer, 44 Decisions That Will Make or Break All Leaders by David Siegel, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by John Behrens. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperfocusaudio.com. To Lara, My Life's Best Decision. Introduction. Working with Adam Newman provided all WeWork executives with an abundance of outlandish stories. A traditional pastime during offsites, in fact, was to swap Adam tales. My favorite of many encapsulates not just the man, but the challenges I would have under him as chief executive officer of Meetup. In January 2019, I was summoned from New York to San Francisco to have a one-on-one with Adam at WeWork's West Coast headquarters in Salesforce Tower. He began the meeting by telling me about what Meetup should evolve into. There was then a short break where Adam decided to shut the lights off and play The Greatest Showman in surround sound while he, myself, and the general manager from Latin America, I had no idea why he was there, sang along. The meeting was then interrupted by a critical call that Adam needed to make to confirm that the samurai swords sent by Masayoshi-san, the largest investor in WeWork, had been delivered to Adam's home. Then his wife Rebecca entered the room, promptly took off her shoes, and asked me who I was. Rebecca recently had been promoted to WeWork's chief brand officer. From my notes, our conversation went something like this. Rebecca, who are you? David, the new CEO of Meetup. Rebecca, what's Meetup? Adam, we acquired Meetup a year ago. Rebecca, we own Meetup? What do they do? David, thinking, the chief brand officer of WeWork doesn't even know they own us? Boy, I feel pretty damn unimportant. Rebecca, you should change the name of the company. It is terrible. Adam, well, they have built a brand for the last 18 years, but we should definitely talk about changing the name. David, thinking, because he's speechless, what the hell did I get myself into? For those of you who are not one of the 30 million people who have attended a Meetup event since our founding in 2002, Meetup is the world's largest platform for finding and organizing community groups. The company's 300,000 groups in 193 countries create and host about 15,000 events every single day. Groups are organized geographically and meet online or in person around a shared interest, such as hiking, video games, or learning Java, or around a shared identity. Meetup groups are run by an organizer who is charged a fee and uses Meetup's online tools to set a time and place for the group's events, find new members, charge fees, screen potential members, upload photos, chat online, and more. Some groups are as small as 3 to 5 members, and some have tens of thousands of members, but every group is its own unique community with the potential to change the lives of its members. Meetup strives to drive both in-person connections and to use technology to connect people of shared interests and identities from around the world. Meetup is a true public good and has bettered the lives of millions of its global members, as its founder, Scott Heiferman, intended when he founded the company following 9/11. He said, "I lived on Houston Street, and everything was shut down south of us for a few weeks. People in our apartment building started to make eye contact in a way they had never done before, and they would ask you how you're doing. When people said hello to each other, you got this very palpable sense of community. I had been the last person in the world to think that local community gatherings or people turning to each other are important, but this really hit me. So I started to read up on the topic. I came across Francis Cairncross's The Death of Distance, who says that in the cyber future, distance won't matter anymore. You can be best friends with people in a sort of virtual world. But I was realizing just how important face-to-face was. Then I read Robert Putnam's Bowling Alone, America's Declining Social Capital, where Putnam throws up this challenge of how do you bring the parts of civil society that are really valuable into this 21st century future? And then I realized that what I should do is help people self-organize to form local communities. In 2002, Scott raised $100,000 in angel funding and later $1.25 million in venture capital. the company launched its website in June 2002 and used these funds to organize events in thousands of cities across thousands of potential topics. Scott created millions of potential meetup events by listing topics as far-ranging as Chihuahua lovers to ADHD support groups. No event would happen until at least four individuals responded that they would attend, and that would trigger an email to them that the event was a go. He then selected three locations as potential venues and had attendees select their preferred location. He made it as easy as possible to organize and attend events and seeded millions of potential opportunities. See Mikolai Piskorsky and David Chen, Meetup, Harvard Business School, Case 710-408, January 2010, revised February 2012. Some 99% of those opportunities didn't trigger an event, but due to sheer volume, he needed a tiny fraction to succeed. And they did. Amazingly, Meetup attracted more than 14,000 users in its first month. 9 months later, the company had 200,000 users. By August 2003, the company grew to 500,000 users and 1,500 types of Meetup groups. The tipping point for Meetup's growth was its political mobilization around the 2004 presidential election. Howard Dean became enamored with Meetup, and by September 2003, more than 40,000 Meetup members had attended a Howard Dean event. Dean's success resulted in both John Kerry and little-known Barack Obama using Meetup for their senatorial bids. Obama even promised that he would personally appear at any Meetup event in Illinois with more than 1,000 RSVPs. In April 2005, the company made a major pivot and decided to start charging $9 per month to its organizers. Scott put a large notice on the website telling organizers, "We have some news to share that we don't think you're going to like." He was right. Meetup declined from 50,000 groups to 4,000 groups overnight, and the company lost 90% of its activity. But the quality of Meetup groups went up substantially, and the percentage of successful Meetup events increased from 4% to 45%. That bold decision to drive quality over quantity saved Meetup from becoming a platform that no one trusted. It wasn't until 2009 that Meetup returned to more than 50,000 groups, but at that point, all its groups were led by paying organizers and hosting meaningful events around the world. Meetup continued to grow revenue, but was unable or uninterested in driving any meaningful profit. It was run more similarly to a nonprofit for years and reinvested any revenue growth that it realized. And then revenue started to flatten. Meetup needed to raise money again and, in the process of fundraising, found its suitor. Enter Adam Newman and WeWork. In November 2017, it was announced that Meetup would be acquired by WeWork for $156 million. Less than 6 months later, WeWork decided to find a new Meetup CEO. That's where I came in. A year after my meeting with Adam, WeWork was in freefall, without a parachute, thanks to its disastrous IPO attempt, which exposed years of financial rot born of Adam's leadership. The company would slam into the ground a few months later due to COVID-19, which exposed its business model's obvious fatal flaw. What if people stopped needing offices? The IPO nearly took down Meetup, and COVID could have also, seeing as we were a company dedicated entirely to facilitating in-person events at a time when you couldn't responsibly meet in person. But instead of failing, Meetup is now more profitable today than at any time in its 18-year history, and we are reinvesting that profit by meaningfully improving our organizer and member experiences. Meanwhile, Adam Newman was replaced as CEO, and WeWork left its space in Salesforce Tower. Why did Meetup succeed while WeWork stumbled? It was in part because of our management team and some critical and company-defining decisions we made along the way. That's a leader's primary job, making smart decisions. Even deciding what decisions to delegate and to whom are critical decisions. Leaders should make very few decisions, and for that reason, those decisions have an outsized impact. While every leader will base their decisions on their unique situation, history, and inclinations, the critical challenges all leaders face are invariably similar, starting with the first. Should you take the job as leader? Other decisions include the following. What do you tell employees on day one? How can you build trust quickly with them? And whom should you trust yourself? Should you make changes quickly, say, to your executive team and the company's strategy, or should you slow play change to maintain stability? And how should you deal with your own boss, even if he's not erratic like Adam Newman? In all, I faced 44 critical challenges at Meetup. These challenges are universal. As a new leader, you will face them too. It sounds like a lot, but they will come in manageable bursts. Your first 30 days, the rest of your first quarter, your second quarter, and the rest of your first year. Then, when your own major crisis inevitably strikes. In this book, I will walk you through how I navigated these challenges myself and came to the decisions I made, both right and wrong, in order to help you understand your options, manage your own hopes and fears, and thus make your own decisions easier and better. And less fraught. Decision-making is hard enough. I think you'll find it comforting to know you're not alone as a leader in sometimes having doubts and feeling inadequate. I hope you won't have to make your decisions amid the chaos of someplace like WeWork, which repeatedly blasted holes in our plans for future success, finally by deciding to sell us and wanting to do so within a month, such that I had to go from saving Meetup for WeWork to saving Meetup from WeWork. I have to say, though, that does make the story more interesting. So if you come for the drama, great. But stay for the decisions. They'll make you a better leader. Chapter 1. Ground Rules. Building Your Personal Decision Framework. Leaders bring to every decision a decision framework built from their earliest experiences and life lessons. So it's important for you to know my history and thus the framework I brought to the 44 key challenges I faced at Meetup, so you can see how you might have done things differently. For instance, I used to be incredibly shy, even afraid. In high school, I was scared of roller coasters, terrified of swimming in a lake, and completely unable to speak in public. Speaking to a girl left me sweaty-palmed and incapable of putting two sentences together. My anxiety wasn't clinical, I just always felt nervous about exploring a new activity or meeting new people. This changed the summer after I graduated. I was a counselor in a sleepaway camp, and for some inexplicable reason, a popular girl, who was one of my fellow counselors, gave all indications that she was interested in me. We spent countless evenings chatting and stayed in close touch during my upcoming pre-college gap year. This relationship gave me confidence in myself, which let me reflect on who I was and how I'd been living. I didn't like it. I resolved not to be scared anymore. I would stand out and take risks, which is easy. Far harder to do, though, was facing why I had initially been shy and scared. In elementary school, kids bullied me and called me names. One summer at camp, I was given a wedgie. It was both physically and emotionally painful. Many of the kids I grew up with were assholes, and many later became adults who were assholes. So the first leadership lesson I learned was to be kind. I wouldn't be the same as those people. I wouldn't hurt others the same way they did. However confident I got, I would remain empathetic, and this would eventually form the basis of my approach to leadership, understanding employee needs, sympathizing with their challenges, motivating others to accomplish more than they thought they could, treating people humanely and minimizing their pain, especially when they were vulnerable, such as during layoffs. That would be my life's calling. My new capacity for risk turned into a desire for adventure, which led me to do the opposite of all my Ivy League counterparts in college. While they took the most challenging classes, I took the easiest classes and put all my time and energy into learning outside of the classroom. I believed that my most transformative experiences became my greatest teachers. Humanity and life experiences taught me more than my classes. Prior to 9/11, there were courier organizations where you gave up your luggage space in return for taking last-minute trips around the world on $99 flights. I did these often. During spring break of my freshman year in college, I called my mom from the airport as I had found an immediate flight to Belgium that week. She was wondering why I was sleeping so late. I had come home for spring break, and she hadn't heard from me that morning. I slept on rooftops in Jordan, sold CD players on the streets of Israel, taught English to Russian immigrants in Brighton Beach, and Hebrew to Ukrainians in Ukraine. I would open a falafel stand in New York City, attend the religious ceremonies of Moonies, Hare Krishnas, and Shakers, and generally find any opportunity to experience something completely different than others. And this while I was still a teenager. I learned the importance of being confident, but never cocky, in making smart decisions. Toward the end of my sophomore year at the University of Pennsylvania, I went to a student conference at Princeton and ended up sleeping on a random student's floor. I asked him what he was doing after he graduated, and he told me he was going to become a consultant. He told me it was the perfect job for someone who didn't know anything but had the confidence to pretend like he knew everything. Sign me up. This was prior to the internet, too, so I asked him to fax me the golden list he'd cobbled together of the 100 largest consulting firms in the United States. I sent each firm my resume, which might as well have been a blank sheet of paper, and eagerly awaited the rush of job offers. Instead, I received 100 rejections, but at least they responded. Then I received a phone call from Mercer Management Consulting. While their New York office had rejected me, they'd sent my letter to their Philadelphia office. Turns out I was the perfect candidate for them, because no one else had applied to be their intern. I got the job without an interview and spent the summer soliciting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.